And I'm here to talk today about something that can be a very daunting topic when we think about the environmental stance of the world, how governments are reacting, what companies are doing. When something is so broad, it's quite hard to think about how it actually influences what we do. So I'm going to talk today about ESG, environmental, social, and governance factors, how that influences investing, and really, quite simplistically, the seven things that we think are the basis of what you need to know about this. And I would start off that sometimes in investing, people talk about things being themes. It's the thematic you can invest in. ESG and sustainability is not a theme. It is always and always going to be with us. It's going to infect everything that happens with the investing landscape, and it's just continue to grow. This is not a theme. This is something that's going to be persistent and with us for many, many years to come. So ESG explained, the seven essentials you need to know. The first thing that we need to know is that a lot of people are interested in ESG, just not the people who aren't in this room right now. That with survey shows us that over two-thirds of retail investors really are thinking about ESG, what it means for their portfolios, yet only about 10% are actually putting those factors in their investments when they think about what they're doing within their portfolios, how they're thinking about growing their wealth, that there's this large divergence between interest and application. And often when there is that big gap, how we bridge that gap is through understanding. How we think about this and how we think about our investments can change and have positive impacts around the world. And more importantly, think about how those companies are reacting to it and how they can generate better profits, better returns for shareholders, and ultimately better growth. So to understand ESG, going to run through these seven essentials in a little bit more detail and try not to hit you with too many statistics, but some of the numbers are actually mind-boggling when we start to think about them. The first is that it's affecting everything. I'm sure that most people in this room are already thinking about their impact on the world every day. Every time they buy something, you're no longer thinking about, oh, is this a good price for this? Or are you thinking about, oh, does this present good quality? You're probably thinking about, what's this made of? Who made this? Is this actually having an impact on inequality? Was this made in a sweatshop? Is this going to be recycled? Around the world, more than 50% of people who responded to the survey around, do you make a conscious effort to buy from companies that are protecting the environment? More than half of them said, yes, yes, I do. It varies greatly by where you are in the world. Surprisingly, in China, a high percentage of people think about this when they make those purchases. But that may also explain the fact why China is the largest EV market in the world. They are very much thinking about their environment and what's happening there. So that bottom-up demand, the way that consumers are already thinking about how they purchase and what they purchase, ultimately leads companies to have to react to that. We already see it in the way we get advertised at by companies. They're trying to build up those environmental credentials. They're trying to build up that social license they have with us as consumers to say, hey, we're the good guys. We're actually building things for the better. And so that does already think about how that impacts the return potential of those companies. Importantly, how companies who aren't adjusting to these new social norms, who aren't adjusting to these new environmental considerations, will actually perform in the future. The second big thing that makes ESG not just a theme, but something that's going to persevere, is obviously that governments are backing this in a big way. There has been more than 120 countries around the world that have committed to a net zero target over the coming decades, most by 2050, some earlier, some later. And that's important because that means there's going to be a huge amount of investment that comes through to achieve those goals over time. But more importantly is the shift that you've actually seen from countries that pay lip service to this kind of development in terms of implementing policies that lead to these net zero and thinking about the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions around the world. But it's that change and not just a want to change things, but a willingness to do so. And Europe, the US and China, these account for 50% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions, and they've increased by more than 50% in just the last few years. So these are the big countries that really focus on some of those changes. Importantly, these are the big countries we're already seeing the strongest commitments to actually change that and bring those numbers down. And in fact, in Europe, you can see by 2045 there, the amount of emissions in Europe is virtually going to be zero earlier than 2050 target. Europe is actually one of the regions and the governments that are actually leading the way in terms of how they address sustainability and thinking about carbon taxes, cross-border taxes for companies who aren't doing well in terms of what they think is environmental. And similarly in China. Again, I mentioned China's the largest EV market in the world. It has the highest number of EV recharging. It makes the solar panels that we all consume. For someone who's such a large emitter of greenhouse gases, it's actually the one in absolute terms who's investing the most to change it, because it has the biggest road to go down. Even by 2045, it's only going to roughly half the amount of emissions that it has emitting in 2021, and it will be another 15 years before it gets to zero. But they are changing. They are wanting to bring that down. They are thinking about how they can reduce those emissions. That government support is going to be crucial in terms of thinking about how other companies react, and also in terms of thinking about the regulations. Governments can do this through two ways. Mostly the way I treat my children as well. You've got carrots, so you reward them for best practices, the same way I try and bribe my kids with candy to do the right thing. Or you have sticks. You penalize them for doing the wrong thing, the same way that I yell at my kids when I want them to do something they're not. So this carrots and sticks approach are obviously going to create incentive for companies to want to change as well, to try and enforce these goals. And again, over the long term, because this is a decade-long process, the way that those companies react and adapt to those new changes is obviously going to be important, thinking about who's going to have the first mover advantage in different industries and different sectors, which companies are making the greatest changes, and which companies are lagging but could also catch up. It's not just about those ones that are doing well now, it's about those ones who can show the greatest improvement and add the most value when it comes to thinking about their sustainability or their social presence in the economy. Kind of talked about this a little bit already, but number three is obviously not all sectors are going to feel the same way when it comes to ESG. And as we shift to thinking about the reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, the number one thing that comes up is obviously fossil fuels. So we can think about the shift away from relying on fossil fuels for energy, the shift that's actually happened already over the last decade. You can see 1970, almost half of our energy was by oil. 80% there was coming through, so 75% was coming through oil and coal. And then we are in 2019, and it's about half. And then by 2050, it's all going to be renewables, a little bit of nuclear. We're thinking about natural gas. That shift to the need to electrify our industries, electrify our home, derive energy from those renewable sources, this is going to be one of the largest ways we reduce those greenhouse gases. And it's something that's already starting if we think about the shift away to gas in Australia, the debate that's currently going on if you pick up the papers around hydrogen and the ability for that to support the economy and the technology that's available there. But again, it's the first part. It's the most obvious place where you're going to see this come through. But behind this is all the other companies that rely on this, all those manufacturing industries that can become electric, the ones that can't, the ones that have the ability to adapt to this, the companies that create the technology to actually fulfill these obligations. It's not just these sectors that are being formed. It's not just those most obvious ones around fossil fuels that show the greatest risk. They also show some of the greatest potential if they can change the way they have their attitudes towards this. Take BP. It used to be called British Petroleum. Suddenly the petroleum got dropped. They're thinking more about the P now than anything else. But these companies are changing, they are adapting, and that does create that opportunity and investment potential as these companies learn to shift with these environmental goals. Costs money though, doesn't it? Costs a lot of money to make this happen over the long term. And this is what's quite remarkable in terms of thinking about the investment potential that comes with the sheer volume of money that's needed to actually enact these changes over time and how much and how quickly it's actually increasing. So here we've just broken down the global investment simply in that energy transition portion of climate change. So we're thinking about renewables, yes, we're thinking about solar and wind and hydro, we're thinking about the storage of that energy, the electrification of some industries, carbon capture and sequestration. And you can see in 2022, that was about $1 trillion, $1.1 trillion split between renewables and storage. That's almost a fourfold increase since 2018. That's $1.1 trillion. To put that in context, that's about two-thirds the size of all the economic output of Australia. It's four times the size of the New Zealand economy where I'm from, and it's going to be significantly increased over time. Last year, the US government announced its largest ever package for sustainable and green energy. It was $370 billion. The European Union has committed 600 billion euros to the greening of its economy over the coming years. And they've estimated, just for Europe alone to achieve its net zero target by 2050, they're going to need $4 trillion of investment over that time. $4 trillion. And they're doing currently 1.1 just in last year. And that's only when they're thinking about renewables and electrification of industries. The amount of money that's supporting this is so very, very important because it has to be financed by investors, it has to be financed by governments, it has to be financed by the bond market. But most importantly, what all this does is it lowers the barrier for many private companies to get involved. It lowers the hurdle for private companies to want to address those technologies that are needed to achieve these, to want to do things like hydrogen, to want to make those advances that actually allow for many of these achievements to become. And it really cracks open the door for a lot more private investment to have a much larger impact on this. So number five, ESG is just more about climate. So obviously we focus on the E a lot. It's the thing that gets the greatest attention. It's probably the easiest thing to quantify to a certain extent. But it's more than that. If we think about the social dynamics of how companies operate, we think about our values as people and what we think is right for communities, and how if we think about diversity, how we think about inclusion, how we think about inequality, all these things should probably be reflected in how we think about the companies that we invest in. We focus more and more on their qualities and addressing a lot of these social issues, as well as just how they treat their shareholders and their employees. And there's many ways you can quantify this. This chart just simply shows you one way that we see companies, again, moving to build that social license, moving to build that response to their shareholders that want to see that change. And it looks at the number of mentions of diversity inclusion in earning calls that happen every 6 months mostly. And you can see that this has been steadily building up for the last about 20 years, but in the last two, it's skyrocketed. Because companies know that they have to pay more attention to these issues, that they're getting critiqued by their shareholders and equity analysts when they look at how good are you delivering on these social goals. And that's important because there's a lot of lip service paid to these things. People hear about greenwashing and companies saying the right things or saying they're using money for a certain thing and they're not delivering on it. Having that ability to really drill down within a company and focus on what they're actually doing and whether they're doing what they say they're doing is so very important. It means you need to be very active in terms of listening to company, going through their earnings calls, really seeing what they're delivering on. And JP Morgan has more than 120 equity analysts around the world who do just that. They look at the ability for these companies to do what they say they're going to do. But this really does scratch the top of the surface. It is the tip of the iceberg. And there's so much more that can be done. Around Asia, only 4% of CEOs are women. Only 5% of board members in Asia are women. In Australia and the ASX actually publishes figures around ASX-listed companies and the composition of their board members, the composition of their staff. These are metrics that investors and companies and asset managers are increasingly interested in terms of how they're going to do and how they're going to measure up against some of their values as investors and their values as delivering for their clients in terms of people who invest in their funds. So that focus on ESG is incredibly important in terms of the environment, but you can't just do well on the environment. You've got to do well on social as well. And often a company that does well on social maybe doesn't do so well in the environment. So you've got to take a broad measure of thinking about these factors across the whole of the ESG landscape and not just focusing on one. Obviously, we're at the ASX conference, so we're thinking about stocks. We're thinking about investing in companies and buying shares in them. But anyone who's building a portfolio, and I hope you many are thinking about building portfolios, not just owning equities, you've got to have something to balance out that risk in your portfolio, right? You've got to have something on the other side of the ledger, or maybe you're thinking about income. So please bear in mind, you do need to own fixed income and bonds to do that. And that's where you can actually think about that sustainability and that ESG coming through on the fixed income side as well. And this, again, is a very small but growing share of the universe in terms of that fixed income and the products that are now available to you. This just shows you the composition of the sustainable bond market, if you want to put it that way. So we have green bonds, sustainable bonds, bonds that are issued specifically for social projects. You can see that in 2018, it was virtually nothing. You know, it's about $200 billion. 2022, it's close to a trillion. Some estimates say that the bond market for these things, green, social, and sustainable, will account for $50 trillion. That's massive. That's a huge chunk of money, $50 trillion in demand for bonds just to fulfill projects that are green, sustainable, and social. And that's important because when you issue debt for a project that's classed as sustainable or green, that money has to be used specifically for that project, not for something else. And companies are wanting to do that because that means investors can put that in their portfolio and they have something that fills those ESG criteria. And also because we're thinking long-term about many of these issues. We're thinking about multi-decades to address some of the problems that we have in our environment or even societies. We're thinking about the long-term and complex nature of those products. And that does mean you need a long-term investment that comes with the fixed income side of things, that issuing debt for 10 years that you can partake in and participate in. And importantly, often these pay out a higher level of income. They have what's called a greenium built into them, that you actually get a little bit more income than you might get elsewhere because they're defined for certain projects and they must be delivered for those projects. But that nature of having something that can fill both sides of your portfolio, whether it's on stocks or bonds, is again another important feature that's often overlooked when people think about fixed income, what can sometimes be a relatively dry asset class. There's opportunities within that that come through in terms of thinking about green bonds, sustainable bonds, and how you fulfill that within your portfolio. Number seven, the last one and the most important one, it comes back to that idea around interest versus application. A lot of it's through demand, but so much more is through access. So perhaps you want to have these environmental and social bonds or environmental and socially sustainable companies within your portfolios or your assets that you own, but their products just aren't there. That's very much changing as you see the number of products that are actually listed as being sustainable in their nature that you now have access to as an investor. You can see this is just showing you that the flows across different areas are changing. Again, Europe, so much further forward in thinking about sustainability and thinking about the regulatory environment that's been put forward in terms of the achieving that net zero target. You can see that 20% of assets in Europe were sustainable assets. It's a bit less lower in the US, they're a bit slower. They, as I mentioned, just invested all that money or allocated that money to bring up their renewable targets. But it's growing. They had $50 billion was in sustainable assets in 2022. I mean, this is just going to be an area that grows. And importantly, it creates that demand. And when there's demand for investors, you often find that asset managers and those people who create financial products respond by creating more access, by giving you the things that you want to invest in. And this is important because that demand and supply starts to roll forward, it gains momentum. And this is why this becomes so very, very sustainable in terms of not being that thematic, but being something that just perseveres and becomes second nature when you start thinking about your portfolio and the assets that you own. They very much just become everything that is geared towards sustainability to making that positive change in the outlook for both the economy, the global environment, and society as a whole. Finally, I would just like to summarize and say that the more we talk to clients about sustainability, and I would stress this in the Australian landscape, if I talk to any pension company or any of the supers, they don't want to talk about anything that doesn't have sustainability in it. They only want to talk about sustainable products. That's because they realize that what they're doing very much has a social good element to it, has an environmental good element to it, that they can inflict that change. And there's no trade-off between doing a positive financial return and doing a positive economic or social return. So there's two products listed on the screen there, the ASX tickers. We've got TEMP, which that three is an E because apparently no one at JP Morgan knows how to spell TEMP. And also we have JPSI. If I was a teacher or a lecturer, I would say, make note, that's going to be on the exam if you go out and chat to either Stephanie or Mark out at the JP Morgan stand outside, worth noting those tickers there. But please just bear in mind that as you think about sustainability, as you think about ESG, as you think about how you put that into your portfolios, it is so much so about doing both well and good in that portfolio, and those things cannot be stripped apart anymore. They're something that's going to be the focus for investors already as they think about their portfolios in the future.